That is one of the great hymns, I believe, in the history of the church. I've told you the story of that hymn. It's written by a man named Horatio Spafford. He was actually a fairly wealthy man in England and was involved in revival services with one of the great, may have been Moody, Dwight Moody, I'm not sure, but involved in a lot of preaching. And he was kind of a behind-the-scenes financier of it. And he and his family had been invited to come to America to help with the revival that was going to take place down here. And so he had some business to attend to in London and told his wife to go head for America by boat, and he would catch up with them there. A few days later, he got a wire back from his wife. The boat that they were traveling on had tragically been lost at sea, and his wife had survived, but all of their children perished in the sea. Of course, he was devastated by this, but his wife had made it to America, and he took another boat. And during the journey, the captain of the boat came to him and said that they were now passing over the very waters where his children had drowned. He went to his cabin and he reflected and prayed, and he wrote down the words, "When peace like the river tendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well. It is well with my soul." A great hymn penned out of great loss. Those who want to be a witness for Jesus Christ will go through trials, often even great opposition. And our response, how we respond in the midst of those times, is what gives our faith credibility. This morning we are in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, where Paul does something he would rather not have to do. He has to defend his ministry from those who doubt his genuineness. And we'll start with verses 1 and 2. It says, "As God's co-workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain. For he says, 'In the time of my favor I heard you, and in the day of salvation I helped you.' I tell you, now is the time of God's favor, now is the day of salvation." And we'll stop there for right now. But to do a little review of last week's message, Paul talked about how God has given us the ministry of reconciliation, and God has given us the message of reconciliation. We go to our next slide. Paul said this in verses 19 and 20. Chapter 5, he said, "And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation." What is reconciliation? Be restoring a relationship. "We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God." Paul has been talking about how there's a ministry that we're reconciling the world to God, and we're reconciling you to God because the Corinthian church had kind of fallen away a little bit. But Paul also now has to turn his attention to the fact that there has to be reconciliation between himself and the Corinthian church. There's been a breach in their relationship that he wants to mend. But he says, I do not want you to receive God's grace in vain. Why does he say that? I don't want you to receive God's grace in vain. You see, the Corinthians, they were saved. They knew Jesus Christ. They had accepted the word of God. They received his grace through faith in Christ. But the Corinthian church, at least many in the Corinthian church, were in a very real danger of throwing that grace away. Their relationship with Paul had been broken, but that mirrored a broken relationship with Christ, as false teachers were affecting and infecting the Corinthian church, and many of the people were in a lifestyle of sin, and they were going to the pagan idols and worshiping there. And we'll get into that more next week. But leaders in the church were committing great sin. And so Paul says, I don't want you to receive God's grace in vain. And then he quotes this passage from Isaiah 49, verses 8 and 9. Let me read those verses. It says this. This is what the Lord says. In the time of my favor, I will answer you. And in the day of salvation, I will help you. I will keep you and will make you to be a covenant for the people, to restore the land and to reassign its desolate inheritances, to say to the captives, come out, and to those in darkness, be free. This is the passage that Paul quotes, and he says that the day of salvation has arrived. You see, this passage in Isaiah 49, it's a messianic prophecy. It is a prophecy, a prediction about Jesus Christ that is fulfilled through Jesus Christ. It foretells the day when Christ will reign on the earth. And so Paul is saying here, look, that day of salvation has come. He's not just saying, like, for you individually, today is the day where you can be saved. He's saying salvation has now come to the earth. God has brought Jesus. He's brought the Savior. He's acted to save by his own hand. The train has left the station, and the salvation is going down the track. Corinthians, you've jumped off the train. It's time to get back on. Don't receive God's grace in vain. Don't leave it behind, but instead get back on board. You're saying you're a part of something far bigger. This isn't just about you and your individual relationship with Jesus Christ. This is about God's announced salvation that he predicted centuries before has now come. Why are you leaving? It's time to be reconciled to Christ. It's time to get serious. And then Paul does something that he'd really rather not do. He has to defend his honor and his integrity against false accusation from some in the Corinthian church that were accusing him of not being authentic or not being really God's apostle, that he was a fake, a fraud. So he defends. He decides that we've got to deal with this. We've got to bring resolution to this. And this is a Christ-like thing. And we can go to the next passage here. Therefore, if you are offering your... This Jesus says this. If you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to them. Then come and offer your gift. So to put that maybe in our perspective, I'm glad you're here this morning. I want everybody to be here on Sunday morning. It's good for us to gather together. But if you're on your way to church and you remember, oh my goodness, me and my sister had this big fight last week. It's okay to skip. Your pastor's telling you it's okay to skip church, go to your sister's house, make things right, because that's what you need to do, restoring that relationship. Paul needs to restore a relationship with the Corinthian church. Elvis Presley famously saying, we can't go on together with suspicious minds. We need to get the suspicion between us taken care of. We need to make peace here. Because if Paul isn't able to set matters straight, the Corinthian church, they may ultimately reject not only Paul, but the message that Paul preaches. They may reject Jesus Christ and then they really will have received God's grace in vain. So he says in verse 3, we had put no stumbling block in anyone's path so that our ministry will not be discredited. We put no stumbling block in anyone's path. The Greek there really says we offended no one. Now, let me explain what's meant by that. He's not saying that Paul never said anything that could offend somebody, because if you're preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, that's not really possible, is it? Jesus, the gospel itself is offensive to our flesh, right? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father except through me. From our world's perspective, that's pretty offensive, isn't it? Because the Buddhists are saying, well, what about Buddha? And the Muslims are saying, what about Muhammad? And all the other religions are saying, what about my way? I can get to heaven, right? And Jesus says, no, nobody comes to the Father except through me. That's pretty offensive to our flesh. So we understand that the truth is that no religion can get you there. It can't get you across the finish line because you can't earn your way to heaven. God has to pay that penalty for you, which is what Christ did. So Paul's not saying here, I've never said anything that's offended anybody. What he's saying is that the character that I've displayed, nothing in my conduct or my character would get me rightfully labeled a hypocrite so that my hypocrisy would be a stumbling block that would prevent somebody from putting their faith in Christ. We talked about this morning in Sunday school, that so many times the reason that people reject Jesus Christ is not because they have a problem with the message or they doubt whether he really was raised from the dead. A lot of times the reason that people reject Jesus Christ is because, well, I knew that Christian, he's a hypocrite, I don't want to be like him, so I'm not going to come to Jesus. I'll be spiritual, or I'll be religious, I'll believe in God, but I'm not going to go so far as to call myself a Christian because I've seen that go wrong. Paul says, I can honestly look at my life and say that nothing that I've done would get me rightfully labeled a hypocrite. I've put a stumbling block in front of nobody. And then Paul goes on and he uses a series of literary devices in order to make his case. I'm just going to read verses 4 through 10. Feel free to follow along. But he goes through these incredible lists and kind of word plays here. Rather, as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way, in great endurance, in troubles, hardships, and distresses, in beatings, imprisonments, and riots, in hard work, sleepless nights, and hunger, in purity, understanding, patience, and kindness, in the Holy Spirit, and in sincere love, in truthful speech, and in the power of God, with weapons of righteousness in the right hand and in the left, through glory and dishonor, through bad report and good report, genuine, yet regarded as impostors, known, yet regarded as unknown, dying, and yet we live on, beaten, and yet not killed, sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, poor, yet making many rich, having nothing, and yet possessing everything. Beautiful passage here that we're just going to kind of go through a little bit at a time. But he starts out by saying, we commend ourselves in every way. We've talked about this in sermons past in 2 Corinthians, that these false teachers, these peddlers of the gospel, who claim to be something even though they weren't, they would have these letters of recommendation from other spiritual people that said, you can believe Bob, he's a good guy, he's a good preacher of the word, and listen to him. Letters from other people saying this is somebody you should listen to. Paul says, I don't need letters of recommendation. Instead, he says here, I'm going to tell you my credentials. I'm going to prove my credentials by the integrity, by the sincerity, and the perseverance that I've shown in my ministry. And that's what he goes about to describe here. So we can go to the next slide here. Paul starts out, I forgot this. Our conduct gives credibility to our words. An old pastor used to say this, and I love it. Your walk talks and your talk talks, but your walk talks louder than your talk talks. You hear that? In other words, what you say is important, but the way you live your life, your conduct, that's what gives real credibility to your message. And Paul says, as I look at not just my talk, because my talk talks, my walk talks too, and my walk, it's pretty good. He's not trying to brag. He's saying, I'm going to show you that my ministry can be believed. So we go to the next slide here. On the left side, verses 4 and 5, Paul talks about the things that he endured for the sake of the gospel. And those first three, the ones in white there, he talks about troubles and hardships and distresses. These are the kind of things that you can expect to happen to you if you preach the gospel of Jesus Christ in a culture that is opposed to your message. He talks about, I've been oppressed. That's what the troubles refer to, is oppression that comes. He's been targeted. Those hardships refers to being targeted because of his faith. And in distresses, that word in the Greek kind of means that I'm not in control of my life. Things are happening that are beyond my control because of my ministry to Christ. You read through the book of Acts and you see all sorts of stories. One of my favorite stories in the book of Acts is with Paul, and I think it's Silas or I think Barnabas. He's with one of his other friends, right? He's preaching in the city. And they do this miracle. And so the people think, these are gods. And what do? They start trying to sacrifice to Paul and his friend.
And Paul says, no, no, stop. We're not gods. Don't worship us. You've got to worship the one true God. God used to be, like, he overlooked the sin in the past, but now you need to repent and put your faith in Jesus. And then some Jewish people that opposed Paul come, they rile up the crowd, and they go from being worshipped in one moment to now they're trying to stone him to death. Things can quickly get out of control in Paul's life. And that's what he's referring to here when he talks about distresses, that there's things that happen that are beyond our control, weren't a part of my plan, but I've endured them. The ones in the yellow there talk about the physical toll that Paul has had to his body because of his ministry. He talks about beatings. Later on in chapter 11 here, 2 Corinthians, Paul will mention that he was 5 times given the 39 lashes of a whip by the Jewish leaders, and he was beaten with rods 3 times, which was a Roman punishment. He says imprisonments, he was often in prison, either overnight, just for a night, or for longer periods of time. And he mentions riots. Not where Paul was participated in a riot, but where Paul was the center of attention, where people created riots to try to get him killed, thrown in prison, whatever. He has had a physical toll on his body. And then the last ones there on the left-hand side, the ones in orange, he talks about hard work, sleepless nights, and hunger. Well, what is he referring to the hard work? Well, Paul preached the gospel full-time, but he also worked as a tent maker full-time too. He worked hard, and especially in Corinth, he refused to take any money from them because he said, I'm not going to be accused of doing this only for the money. So he worked a full-time job to provide for himself and ran a church at the same time. And he says, sleepless nights. Why were they sleepless nights? Well, because he was probably preaching during the day and working all night, or possibly praying all through the night for God's wisdom and how to handle the ministry. And he says he dealt with hunger. Well, what was that about? Well, he probably couldn't afford food, or he was so busy with everything he was doing, he just forgot to eat. Anybody done that before? Been so busy, I just forgot to eat today. Paul dealt with these. But then the next two verses, verses 6 and 7, Paul talks about his response to the opposition that came to him. He says, in purity, understanding, patience, and kindness, in the Holy Spirit and in sincere love, in truthful speech and in the power of God, with weapons of righteousness in the right hand and in the left. So what were his response to these hardships? Well, he kept his purity. He kept his integrity in the face of those hardships. He didn't respond with anger. He didn't respond by falling into sin, but he stayed pure. He says understanding. He used wisdom, not anger, in his response. He says patience and kindness. Where do those two come in? We see those in Galatians. And what? To a fruit of the Spirit, right? Paul says, I respond with the fruit of the Spirit when I'm attacked, with patience, and I'm kind, even to my attackers. And he says, the Holy Spirit, in other words, with grace. God gives me the grace to handle things, not from the flesh, but from the Spirit of God. And then in sincere love, God has given me the ability to love even my enemies, even those who are attacking me, and that shows credibility to what I'm doing. He then talks about truthful speech. That can also be interpreted as the word of truth. When Paul is under opposition, when he's been thrown in prison, when he's been attacked, he responds with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And then, by the power of God. In other words, Paul, even though Paul's going through these things, God showed up as the Holy Spirit does miracles and displays the power of God through Paul as the Spirit gives Paul strength to do the things that he has to do. And then he says, and through weapons of righteousness in the right hand and the left. What's the picture there? It's like a military guy, right? It's like a soldier. I've got a sword in my right hand. I've got a shield in my left. In other words, I'm going to war with Satan consistently. I'm ready to defend the truth of the Word of God. I'm not going to fall short. I'm not going to cower in fear. Instead, I'm ready to defend the gospel. And I love what he says there, through glory and dishonor, bad report and good report. In other words, whether people like me or not, whether I'm well received or not, Whether people think I'm awesome or people think I'm terrible, I'm consistent, and I have been. And then Paul lists in the following verses, verses 8 and following, he talks about people's perceptions about him versus the truth. And that's in our next slide. And I love the way he does this. He says, first, he says, I'm genuine, but regarded as imposters. In other words, I know I'm doing the right thing. I'm doing what God wants, even though people will look at me and say, no, there's nothing to Paul. He's a fake. And then he says, known, but regarded as unknown. In other words, who is he known by? He's known by Jesus Christ. You are known by Jesus Christ. God knows us. He has a plan for us, right? And even though people sometimes look at us, and they definitely looked at Paul and said, we don't know who you are. Where's your letters of recommendation, right? I don't know who you are, so I'm not going to listen to you. Paul says that God knows who I am. He knows what I'm doing. He knows that I'm on the side of truth. Dying. The perception was that Paul was dying. That's one of the reasons that they may have rejected him. They're like, Paul's always getting in trouble. He's always facing death. He's not going to be around much longer. Maybe we should, you know, put our trust in somebody with a longer shelf life. Because, yeah, I might be perceived as dying, but yet I live on. By God's grace, by God's Spirit, I continue to live. He says, beaten. Yes, I've been beaten. I've been opposed, and I've had to face consequences because I stand up for the truth of Jesus Christ. But guess what? The Romans might have beat me 3 times. The Jews might have beaten me 5 times. I'm still alive by the grace of God. That shows. And I'm still going. That shows that my word and that my ministry are pure. He acknowledges that the things that people say about him are true. Yes, I'm weak. Yes, I'm beaten. You know what? I might die soon. Paul, when he writes 2 Corinthians, he just came out of a period where he almost died. And he's, I might die soon. But you know what? That doesn't discredit me. Quite the opposite. It reveals that I'm following the footsteps of Jesus. My ministry is the same ministry that Jesus tried to do. Because Jesus was beaten. Right? And Paul was beaten. But by God's grace, Paul was still alive. Jesus was a man of sorrows. And Paul says sorrowful, but yet always rejoicing. I have experienced sorrows, but yet I have the courage to rejoice even in the midst of those circumstances. Right? Paul says, yes, I am poor. Just as Jesus was poor, the Son of Man had no place to lay his head, Jesus said. But Paul, like Jesus, makes people rich. How he brings a message of salvation. I don't have money, but what I do have, I give to you. And that's that you can have forgiveness through Jesus Christ. And then finally, Paul says, having nothing, yet possessing everything. Ephesians 3:16 through 19, Paul says this. He says to the Ephesian church, I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through the Spirit, through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp, listen to this, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Where Paul has said in 2 Corinthians 6, he said, I have nothing materially, I don't have much, but possessing everything. Well, what do we possess according to Paul here in Ephesians? How high and deep and wide and love is the love of God through Jesus Christ. It's so big, you can't get your arms around it. And our inheritance is so wonderful, we can never fully appreciate it. That's what we have through Christ. We possess everything through Christ. And Paul says, so do I. In the kingdom of God, our integrity and our perseverance in the midst of struggle reveals God's power within us. And it proves that not only is our faith genuine,
so is the gospel that has claimed us. The gospel is proved true through our response in difficulty. And then Paul says this in verses 11 through 13, back to 2 Corinthians 6. He pours out his heart here. He says, "We have spoken freely to you, Corinthians, and opened wide our hearts to you. We are not withholding our affection from you, but you are withholding yours from us. As a fair exchange, I speak as to my children, open wide your hearts also." In verse 11 there, he says, "We have spoken freely to you." The Greek is, our mouths are wide open. In other words, we're telling you everything we can. We've been completely honest with you. We've held nothing back from you. I've not deceived you in any way. You can see everything that has come out of my mouth is true. We've been honest with you. We've given you everything that we can. And this church that is struggling with whether they should accept Paul or reject him, Paul says, "I've been completely honest with you." But then in verse 12, he says, "We are not withholding our affection from you, but you are withholding yours from us." The Greek seems a little bit disgusting to us in our Western mindset. The Greek actually says, where it says you are withholding yours from us, the Greek says you are constricted in your bowels. How's that for pleasant? You are constricted in your bowels. You see, in the ancient world, it was thought that the bowels were the center of human emotion. Like when we're upset, our stomach turns, and we kind of, you know, your guts kind of do some things. And so that was thought that that was the center, that's where emotion comes from, is from the bowels. And to say you're constricted in your bowels is kind of an unpleasant word picture, right? But Paul's kind of saying, like, you need some spiritual Pepto-Bismol because things aren't right down there. You need to, we'll leave aside the bowel thing real quick. But essentially what Paul is saying, Corinthians, your love for me has grown cold. You're withholding your love from me. But it's not really just about Paul, because their rebellion against Paul, really what it reveals is the rebellion against Christ. Because as Paul has proclaimed the true word of God, they're turning aside from Christ to a false gospel. They've been rebelling against the truth. And as he confronted in 1 Corinthians, and it also makes reference here in 2 Corinthians at times, they've turned to immorality, they've turned to division, to greed, to idol worship. We'll get into that more next week. They've turned against the messenger because they've turned against the message. Paul says, we need to turn that around. You need to stop withholding your love from Christ. You need to stop withholding your love from me. And he puts his cards on the table here. As a fair exchange, I speak as to my children, open wide your hearts also. Paul does something in the Greek world was not done. He really appeals, he begs for their love. That wasn't done in the Greek world because it really puts you at a disadvantage, right? It'd be like, you know, somebody going to a restaurant and proposing to their girlfriend, getting down on one knee. Like, that's a pretty, what if she says no? Like, you gotta be confident in that, right? It's like in the Seinfeld episode when George tells this girl he loves her, right? And she doesn't respond back, and I love George, or what Jerry later says, "You say I love you, that's a pretty big matzah ball out there." Like, you gotta be confident in the return. And that's what Paul's doing. He's saying, he's shouting, "I love you, Corinthians!" And he's just hoping that they respond back, and "We love you too." Because if they don't, that's gonna be pretty humiliating for Paul. But he speaks to them not as a master to his servants, not even as a teacher to his students. Instead, what does he say there? He says, "I speak as to my children." He sees himself as their father. He's the one that brought them to faith in Christ. He's loved them as his own children. He's reprimanded them the way a father sometimes has to. But now he says, it's time to come home. It's time to come home, put your faith back in Christ, trust in me, trust my message. Recognize that God's truth is in what I've taught you. It's in my ministry. So now return to Christ and embrace the message of salvation for real. Because now is the day of salvation.
God's salvation has come. You need to respond again to that. Be reconciled to God. So what do we do with this, right? This is kind of a complicated message because there's just a lot of really cool things Paul says in there. But what do we do with it? Because it's easy for us to say, well, look, I'm already saved, right? So I don't know if this really applies to me. But as we said, when Paul says now is a day of salvation, this isn't even really about whether you and I as individuals put our faith in Christ. That's important, but really it's not just about our individual salvation. It's that salvation has come, and we have to not just respond to it and say, okay, yes, Jesus, you can be Lord of my life, but fully embrace it. Fully embrace the fact that God has revealed his salvation to the world, and we need to get on board and be about his business and his ministry. See, when we're struggling, it can be easy to think that maybe I can't be effective in my witness because I'm struggling. Right? Who's been there before? Like, I'm just no good to anybody right now because I'm spiritually beat down and there's no possible way I could possibly minister to anybody. But Paul's words here reveal something different. They reveal that during these trials, God can be most glorified because our faith is revealed as genuine. Go to the next slide here. This is what Peter says about it. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief and all kinds of trials. These have come. Why have they come? These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold which perishes, even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Peter says the difficulties show that your faith is true and genuine, that it's not going to fail, and one day as you continue to persevere, when Jesus Christ comes back, you're going to receive the reward that's been promised to you. So hang in there. We can also learn from this that as Paul has gone through such difficulty, he says, sorrowful yet rejoicing. We have a lot to praise God for. Let's go to the next slide. What can we praise God for in the midst of our trials? First of all, and I'm just borrowing this from Paul's list that he gives us in these verses. We are genuine. Our faith is genuine, and God isn't letting us go. Secondly, even though it may seem like people don't know who we are known by God. God knows you intimately, and he has revealed his love to you. That's something we can praise God for in every season of life. Third, we are alive. Not just physically alive, we are spiritually alive, and God has promised an eternal life through faith in Christ. That's something we can rejoice in. Next, as Paul says, you know, we are beaten but not killed. That's all about God just sustains us. God continues to sustain us even in the midst of difficulty. We can praise God for that. He says, sorrowful but always rejoicing. We also can always be rejoicing. Why? It's not that we don't go through sorrow. Of course we do. But sorrow cannot rob us of the joy of our salvation. In fact, sorrow can sometimes remind us that as we talk about this world is not my home, and there's something far better for me that I'm looking forward to. So we can rejoice in that. He says, I am poor, but I'm making many rich. We also make many rich because God has given us the message of reconciliation that we can testify to in our world. And finally, even though we're poor, we possess everything. Because we're made an heir to the kingdom of God, which is far greater than anything we could possibly imagine. Paul says in another passage, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has in store for those who love him. We just can't even imagine it. Which is really why I think so little is really said about heaven and what it looks like and what it's going to be like. Words don't do it justice. So I guess as we close, and just a minute as I pray, our worship team will come up, just to pray that whatever your circumstances, that God may prove the genuineness of your faith and use you to impact others for eternity. And resolve to praise God in all circumstances. Father in heaven, we thank you for Paul's words. Thank you for his courage, for his tenacity, defending not just himself. It's not really about him. It's about the message that he's proclaimed. And Lord, I pray that you would give us the ability to trust in you at all times. Be able to say, it is well with my soul. And that as others look at us, that we would understand that we, even in our hardest moments, Father, you are using us for your kingdom and you are proving yourself genuine through our message. Help us, Lord, to rejoice because we know that we represent a kingdom that is eternal and that is coming soon. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. First song we're going to sing is Praise You in the Storm. Because we go through these storms in life, right? And it's that courage to say, I'm sorrowful, yet rejoice. That is a choice that we make. I was sure by now you would have reached down to my dark tears and grief. Step in and save me. So once again, save me.
Praise you in the storm.
endures forever. Your love just never quits, even when we're tempted to give up. And so, Lord, I pray that as we leave this place in a few minutes, that you would help us to draw near to you, to press in throughout the week, Father. Draw near to you, because the day of salvation has come, and we've already received part of it, Father. We've already responded. But it's a salvation that we go deeper into. We don't just kind of stay at where we're at, but we draw closer to you. Help us to do that. Because your love doesn't fail, and it won't fail us. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to sing One Thing Remains. Testimony. We ask that you would receive the glory for it. In Jesus' name. you so much. Have a wonderful week. We'll see you next Sunday, Memorial Day weekend.